All right, welcome back, everybody. Let's continue to talk about power analysis. The last time we were together, I just reminded you what power is, and we spent quite a bit of time looking at this graphic right here. Power, of course, is the probability of correctly rejecting a false null hypothesis. So in other words, power is the probability of not making a type 2 error. Well, today, let's talk about some factors that affect power. Because if we can really understand those factors, then we can design a study so that we can maximize the probability of finding differences that actually do exist. All right, let's talk about four different factors that affect statistical power. Two of those factors that affect power are the alpha level and also determining if we're going to do a one-tail test or a two-tail test. And let's talk about those two factors together. Because once we select an alpha level, we also need to determine if we're going to do a one-tail test or a two-tail test. So really, when you think about it, those two separate factors are linked together. Let's change views and look at that graphic a little bit more closely, and then we'll take some notes along the way. Remember this example from a previous video? It was describing the Flynn effect. And the Flynn effect essentially states that over time, collectively as a culture, we get more intelligent. So if we, today, were to take an intelligence test from 30 years ago, even though the people 30 years ago, on average, would score 100, we today would almost certainly score higher. So if we were to collect data and test that, we would form two competing hypotheses. And the null hypothesis would state that the population mean IQ for the people today taking that test would equal 100, just like the population IQ from the people 30 years ago. And then the alternative hypothesis, of course, would state the population mean IQ for the people today would be something other than 100. That's what we would do for step one. And then in step two, we would determine where the critical regions are located. In other words, we'd find out how much evidence do we need to reject the null hypothesis. That means we would have to create a distribution of all possible sample means based on the null hypothesis being true. And if the null hypothesis is true, we would expect to find lots of means right around 100. So that our discussion right now matches this graphic, let's just assume we set this up as a one-tail test. And for right now, let's assume we're using an alpha of 0.05. That would mean in this distribution of all possible sample means, we'd have to mark off where the most extreme 5% is. Let's assume that the most extreme 5% of the sample means is marked off right here, and that that value, that critical value, corresponds with an IQ score, a mean IQ score of 118. Well, remember, right now, we're talking about power. So we're saying the true situation in the real world is that the null hypothesis is not true. And what is true is that the population mean IQ score for the people taking that test today is something other than 100. And for this example, we're going to assume that today's population would score about 10 points higher. So their mean IQ score would be 110. That means our attention is now focused on this distribution of all possible sample means. And we want to find the area in that distribution associated with sample means greater than 118, and that would be this area right here. Anytime we collect data and we find a sample mean that exceeds 118, we will have enough evidence to correctly reject the null hypothesis. Well, how often is that going to happen? How often are we going to find sample means that are greater than 118? If we can find the area in that shaded portion, we can find the probability of finding sample means in that range. Keep in mind, the mean for this distribution is 110. So this distribution of all possible sample means is split right down the middle, right here at 110. And half the distribution would be to the right. This is not even half the distribution. So that area right there we know is less than 50%. Let's just estimate how big we think that area is. I'd say that area is about 35% of the entire distribution. That, my friends, would mean that for this statistical test, our power would equal 35%. In other words, in this situation that we just mapped out, we would only have a 35% chance of correctly rejecting the null hypothesis and finding statistically significant results. Well, remember why we're here. We're trying to determine how alpha influences power. So let me clear away some of the notes that we made, and let's go through the same example using an alpha level of 0.01. In this example, we're going to use a more rigorous alpha level, an alpha level of 0.01. Remember, that would mean over the long run, now we would only be making type 1 errors 1% of the time. So from that original sampling distribution, we would need to find where the most extreme 1% of the sample means. Let's assume that that critical value would be right about here. I'll draw a line there to show that's where our critical region begins. And let's assume that's where we would find a sample mean IQ score of 125. So we won't be able to reject the null hypothesis unless we find a sample mean that exceeds that value. Well, again, I'm reminding you, we're talking about power. So we are assuming that there really is an effect. We are assuming that the null hypothesis is false. And if the alternative hypothesis is true, we would expect to find lots of sample means right around this area. So how often would we find a sample mean that exceeds 125? Well, we can answer that question by finding out where the sample means are that exceed 125, and they're in that area. If we can find this area of the distribution, we can figure out the probability of finding sample means in that range. Let's go ahead and estimate how big we think that area is. That's somewhere around maybe 15% of that sampling distribution. That would mean our power level for this particular example would equal 15%. In other words, we would only have a 15% chance of correctly rejecting that false null hypothesis. Let's go ahead and erase some of those notes and go through one more example, this time with an alpha level of 0.001. An alpha level of 0.001 is really very stringent. We would need a lot of evidence to find statistically significant results. An alpha level of 0.001, at least theoretically, caps the probability of making a type 1 error to about one time out of every 1,000 tests. So let's revisit this original distribution and figure out where is the most extreme 0.1%. And let's assume that it's somewhere right around there. I'll draw a line. That line represents where our critical region begins. And let's just assume that that critical region begins with a sample mean IQ score of about 129. If we wanted to compute the power associated with this specific test, we would have to find where are all the sample means that exceed 129. And then we would need to find the area in the distribution associated with means in that range. Let's go ahead and estimate it. That is a relatively small chunk from that sampling distribution. I estimate it's somewhere around 5%. That means, in this example, if we're using an alpha of 0.001, we would only have a 5% chance of correctly rejecting that false null hypothesis. You've probably noticed a trend. As these alpha levels increase from 0.001 to 0.01 to 0.05, the power levels are increasing as well, from 5% to 15% to 35%. So in general, one way to sum it up when we're trying to think about the influence of alpha level on power is that as alpha levels increase, power levels increase as well. So far, all of our examples have focused on a one-tailed test. Let's see how power would differ if we did a two-tailed test. Let me erase some of our notes so it's easier to see my point. Let's go back to our original example where we looked at an alpha of 0.05 for a one-tailed test. We put all of that alpha level, all of that 5% into one tail. And we noted that the critical value would be somewhere around 118. Well, remember what happens when we do a two-tailed test. Now we need to take that 5% and we have to split it between two tails. So in this case, 2.5% of the most extreme sample means would be right here and somewhere around right here. It's pretty clear what happens when we move from a one-tailed test to a two-tailed test. The critical region gets smaller, and that means the area associated with statistical power gets smaller. So as we move from a one-tailed test to a two-tailed test, we lose power. And you can see that graphically right here. When we did a one-tailed test, all of this area right in here represented our statistical power. But when we do a two-tailed test, also with an alpha of 0.05, it is only this area right in here that I'm shading that represents our statistical power. So overall, one-tailed tests are more powerful and two-tailed tests are less powerful. All right, that was a pretty good summary of how alpha levels and whether a test is one-tailed or two-tailed affects our statistical power. Next, let's talk about the effect size. You probably remember that we measure effect size using Cohen's D. Cohen's D is a standardized measurement of effect size, so it measures differences between groups in standard deviation units. In general, a relatively small D value, like 0.2, is considered a small effect size, but a relatively large Cohen's D value, like 0.8, is considered a large effect size. Look at our original example. Regardless of if we would consider it small, medium, or large, the size of the effect that we see is 10 points. The people today who are taking that test from 30 years ago are scoring about 10 points higher. But look and see what happens to our power levels when we increase the size of the effect. In this particular example, the people today taking that test from 30 years ago are scoring on average 20 points higher. So in this example, the effect size is much larger. You can see when that effect size is much larger, the overlap between the null hypothesis distribution and the alternative hypothesis distribution is much less. As a result, it becomes much more likely that we will find a sample mean within that critical region. So in other words, as effect size increases, power levels increase as well. And that should just make sense to you intuitively. If there's a really strong effect, a really dramatic effect, it should be easy for us to find. But if there's a relatively small effect, a relatively subtle effect, it'll be much more difficult to find. The fourth key factor that I want to talk about is sample size. Sample size can have a profound effect on statistical power. Compare these two graphics. In this graphic, the difference between the people taking the test 30 years ago and the people taking the test today is a difference of 20 points. That's exactly the same difference in this graphic right here, 20 points. However, in this graphic right here, you see that these two distributions overlap much less. If they overlap less, that means it's much more likely that we will find a sample mean that's in the critical region. In this example right here, you can see where the critical region is, and you can see that about maybe 55% of this distribution is within that range. So power would be about 55%. But look at this distribution right here. Again, here's the critical region. In this case, about 95% of the distribution is within that critical region. So in this case, power would equal 95%. Well, the question is, what changed? What's the difference between those two examples? This third graphic that we see right here is based on having a large sample size. Keep in mind, when we have a large sample size, what I'm telling you is I have lots of evidence. I have lots of data. So to some extent, that should make sense intuitively. If I have lots of data, if I have lots of evidence, I should have a statistical test that has more power. In other words, when I have lots of data, when I have lots of evidence, I should have a better chance of finding differences that really do exist. But that still doesn't answer the question of why there is so much less overlap between these distributions. And here is the answer. You already know the answer. You learned this answer weeks ago. What happens when we increase sample size? As n increases, what decreases? Standard error of the mean. Do you remember learning that long ago? As sample size increases, standard error of the mean decreases. That means as we measure more and more people in our samples, those samples should come closer to the true population mean. In other words, there should be less sampling error. Well, if there's less sampling error, these distributions will be more narrow. They will be tighter. when those sampling distributions are more narrow, when they are tighter, they're showing less variability from one sample mean to the next. The thing that makes this particular factor so important when we're talking about statistical power is that it's really the primary factor of the four that is within our control. Remember, it's up to us, the researchers, to determine how large our sample size should be. If larger sample sizes are associated with more statistical power, then we are going to want to have the largest samples possible. The other three factors are really much less in our control. Remember, it's your discipline that determines your alpha level. And in general, we typically do two-tailed tests. And remember, the effect size, that's just what exists out there in the real world. I'm just trying to determine what is the effect size. I'm trying to determine if there is an effect. I have no influence on how big that effect is. But sample size, that I have a lot of control over. So the next time we get together, we are going to learn how to do a power analysis. We are going to learn how to do two different types of power analyses, but the one that will be most helpful to us is the one that helps us determine how many people should we have in our samples to have a sufficient level of power. So we'll talk about that next time. I'll see you in the next video. In the meantime, be safe.